वेलकम। वी आर वेरी हैप्पी टू होस्ट अ सीरीज ऑफ टॉक्स अराउंड टाइगर्स। वी स्टार्ट विथ द कनेक्टिविटी इश्यू, व्हाट वी कॉल द कनेक्टिविटी कंजर्वेशन एंड द वाइल्ड लाइफ कंजर्वेशन ट्रस्ट हैज बीन वर्किंग फॉर सेवरल इयर्स टू फर्स्ट अंडरस्टैंड हाउ द फॉरेस्ट ऑफ सेंट्रल इंडिया एंड ईस्टर्न घाट्स आर कनेक्टेड विथ ईच अदर and how many linear infrastructure projects are going to impinge these corridors and how are we going to a safeguard the movement of animals of all species and try to work simultaneously on policies that can be long lasting and that can help secure corridors not only in central India but across the country and hopefully the learnings from our work in the field will help us educate other countries as well. And there are several other tiger range countries where they have similar issues, where conservation and development are currently jostling with each other. And we are trying to put systems in place so that there is a win-win on both sides, which means that you can have good quality wildlife conservation and development go hand in hand. So, first of all, wish everybody a very, very happy Global Tiger Day. I can speak from all my colleagues, on behalf of all my colleagues in WCT. They are very, very happy to serve this gorgeous species. We don't work for WCT, we work for the tigers and the forest. WCT is just a mechanism for us to do things. There are going to be four talks today. This is the first one. It starts at, so it will end in about 40 minutes. Then we have another one at 2, third at 3, and the final one at 4 o'clock. So there will be 8 speakers that you will be listening to. They are all researchers and employees with the Wildlife Conservation Trust. They have their own specialties, but all of us are connected with each other through our joint passion and our common goals of conservation. With me is Milind Parivakkam, who is first a dear friend and then a colleague in WCT. I know him for many, many years now. We met in 2003, and since then we know each other. We did a master's together at the at NCBS. After which, Milind went and did work with other NGOs, and now he is spearheading our road ecology vertical, single-mindedly trying to see how he can first understand movement of animals across different types of linear infrastructures and then introduce some scientific methodologies to see how we can measure the influence of roads on the species, and the learning from there then take shape. They form white papers, which is then shared with the ministry and the government, so that some of those learnings can be implemented at a national level. So this is going to be a free-flowing discussion between me and him. I'm going to pose a few questions so that we can get the ball rolling. However, before I do that, Milind, do you want to say something to the audience?
Well, I'd just like to, say to everybody, that it's the International Tiger Day, and we have had yesterday a detailed report on tiger numbers has come out, and in spite of the increase in numbers, which is a positive news, in fact, the tiger numbers have gone up, and India has at the moment kind of achieved some of the numbers target, but I think we still have a lot of conservation work to do to protect our corridors. So that is, in a nutshell, my message.
Okay. So Milind, before we start, let me just spend 2 minutes talking about the Central Indian landscape so that people understand how complex this particular landscape is. So there are three major populations of tigers that we consider when we talk of India. One is the Terai Arc population, which is up north along the borders of India, Nepal, India, Bhutan, and also the entire the areas that are in Uttarakhand, Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, that area. Then you have the Central Indian landscape that has about 8 states as part of it. Majorly, it is Madhya Pradesh and Maharashtra. And that part of Maharashtra, which is known as Vidarbha, which forms a very important part of the Central Indian landscape. And it's also obviously connected to the Eastern Ghats, and so you cannot ignore that population. And then you have the Western Ghats. The Western Ghats obviously is very extensive. It starts in Gujarat and ends in Kerala. And it is probably the most robust tiger population on earth. Most parks there are largely contiguous, especially in Karnataka, Kerala and Tamil Nadu, where in fact it's a tri-junction. The best habitat for tigers is considered to be the Nilgiri Biosphere Reserve, which pretty much spans into three states. That's Kerala, you have Wayanad there, and Mudumalai, Mukurthi and all that, which is in Tamil Nadu, and you have Nagarhole, Bandipur and other parks in the Karnataka region. So of the three major tiger populations, you obviously also have tigers in West Bengal, Sundarbans, and you have a very, very good population of tigers in Kaziranga. Kaziranga is well known for rhinos. However, it probably has the highest density of tigers on earth. So what was protected for the one-horned rhino is actually serving the tigers very well. So let's talk about these three populations. Of this, the Western Ghats, as I said, is the most robust because the parks are all connected. Not all, but most of them are. And there is forested corridors connecting those parks. The Terai Arc, unfortunately, which is also a very, very good habitat for tigers, has got hampered in a big way because of fragmentation for many, many reasons. And while there are some patches where you have some of the highest densities of tigers on earth, like Corbett, also extending into Lansdowne region, but most of the parks are highly fragmented and they are far, far from each other. And so, Western Ghats, good. Terai Arc, we have learned from, and that there are some mistakes that were committed there. And Central India has very many, very, very good quality tiger reserves. It extends into lot of states, primarily Madhya Pradesh, Maharashtra, but also Chhattisgarh, parts of Gujarat, and also Rajasthan. So when you look at that entire landscape, you have several protected areas, but they are all far apart. However, if you compare the Terai Arc with the Central Indian landscape, the corridors between these national parks are still intact. In Terai Arc region, a lot of these corridors have been hampered because of anthropogenic reasons. But in the Central Indian landscape, the corridors are still existing. So somewhere, the Central Indian landscape is actually physically also between the Terai Arc and the Western Ghats, but also in the scientific, from the scientific perspective, from the ecology of tigers, it is somewhere in between in terms of threats. And so if we as an organization, we try to look at these complexities, and we said that if we can find solutions for extending the populations of tigers into different areas in Central India, plus safeguarding their corridors, we will be able to provide a formula which will be of immense help to conservationists and governments, not only in India, but so many other tiger range countries who are probably having better connectivity today, but fewer tigers. In future, if the tiger number goes up, the connectivity is surely going to go down, because as we develop in all nations, we are going to build a lot of infrastructure. So we said, let us be proactive. Let us look at a population which is very good quality. The protection in some of the parks in Central India is probably the best that you can think of in any tiger range country. However, there are problems there. And so this particular series of talks that we are going to have today, the four of them, we will focus on different aspects of tiger conservation. So now let's go to somebody who breeds conservation connectivity, somebody who has unflinchingly gone in, worked very closely with various government agencies, also interacted with a lot of NGOs who are working on the ground. WCT, mind you, is not the only NGO that works in Central India. There are several NGOs, and we are part of consortiums that include several NGOs that not only work in conservation, but also on the social aspect. So unless we have an integrated approach, which means we take into consideration hard science, conservation of wildlife, that is behavior and biology of animals, and also communities, we will not be able to solve the problem. So Milind, first question, What is linear infrastructure for the audience? I think it's important for them to know what linear infrastructure means.
Okay. So linear infrastructure is like essentially, you know, any kind of development which is, you know, like linear in nature. It's like, you know, a thin strip. So imagine a railway line or a road or a canal, an irrigation canal, or maybe, you know, pipelines which are built for oil or for, you know, water, and then transmission lines. All of these are, you know, like shaped like a line. So that's where the word linear comes from. And, you know, they will cut through the forest in a straight line. A railway line is, you know, more or less straight. A road also, you know, with some curves is, you know, basically a linear form of development. So essentially roads, railways, irrigation canals, pipelines, and transmission power lines which carry electricity, all of these are clubbed together and called as linear infrastructure because of their shape.
So Milind, I just spoke about so many tiger reserves which are very good. Kanha, Painch, that is both Madhya Pradesh, Maharashtra side. Then you have Melghat, right. You have Satpura, you have Tadoba. Then right. Why do you actually, first of all, let's talk about corridors. Just in short, what is a corridor? And then I'll ask you this question, follow-up question on corridors.
Right. So it's like, you know, in the case of, say, human beings, right? And I suppose tomorrow I want to travel from Nagpur to Bombay. So either I will take a road or maybe I'll take, you know, a railway line. So that is like, you know, a corridor for human beings. I mean, I'm not going to travel randomly. I'm going to take the road or the rail to come to Bombay. So I'm going to follow a particular path. Similarly, what happens is animals also have a need to, you know, travel from one place to the other. Now, their requirements, I mean, I might go to Bombay to, you know, attend a meeting with you or, you know, maybe a conference of some sort. But animals would have different needs. Animals need to travel because they want to find food. Maybe, you know, they want to find mates so that they can breed with, you know, other tigers, like a tiger is searching for another tiger. They're searching for some kind of suitable habitat because, you know, a tiger which is present, say, in point A is, you know, wants to disperse out of here because there's too much competition here. It wants to go and find a new territory for itself. So animals also need to travel to find food, to find, you know, other individuals so that they can mate and maybe, you know, find suitable habitat. And animals will, you know, utilize some kind of, you know, forested pathways, which are, you know, corridors for wild animals. So it's extremely important for animals to also move. And therefore, they need these corridors without which, you know, they cannot, I mean, you know, sustain themselves in the long run.
So one more question I think that people may have is, when you say corridors, does it mean all those forests that connect the parks are corridors, or there are things outside of those forests also which can be considered as part of that corridor?
Right. Primarily, I mean, what you said, you know, is there enshrined in the, you know, legal definition of the law in India also. It very simply put, you know, it's a very simple and elegant definition of a corridor which the law in India has, you know, defined it. It says any patch of, you know, land which connects one protected area to the other. So imagine, like, Painch is one protected area, Kanha is another protected area. So everything in between, you know, between Painch and Kanha is a corridor. Now, the bulk of the corridors are, of course, you know, they comprise of forest lands. And in some cases, what happens is, you know, there might be small breaks in between, you know, this forest patches, which is, you know, say a rural area with agriculture in between. And, you know, during the night time, maybe a tiger can, you know, easily cross through that agricultural patch. So, I mean, it is sometimes, a corridor is also a mosaic of different land use types. I mean, there could be some forest, there may be a river or a stream in between which the animal uses to cross from one forest patch to the other. There might be a little bit of agriculture. So it's both. It's a mix of, different land use types, but primarily, it has to, if there are large tracts of forest, then, there are lesser threats to animals.
Okay, so Milind, when there are so many parks, more than 50, 60 protected areas that we are talking about in
Right.
the area where there is very good quality tiger population, then why talk of corridors? You have Kanha, which has more than 80 tigers,
Right.
Pench together has actually tigers more than Kanha has, if you consider both
Exactly.
Pench together. Tadoba is also extremely rich in terms of tiger population, then you pretty much can protect all those tigers within the boundaries of our tiger reserves. Why do we need the connectivity and why do you need these corridors?
Right. So, what happens is tigers also need to, tigers disperse. I mean, what happens is usually, I mean, a male tiger, which is, say, for example, I'll just again take the example of Kanha and Pench. If there is a, tiger which is born in Pench, he's a cub. And when he grows up, he might find that Pench is a very highly dense, like Pench is the biggest population, right, in the Central Indian landscape. And it's relatively more densely populated. So this tiger is going to have a lot of competition there, to grow up. And he might also, face competition from his own, father or, maybe other tigers nearby. So this tiger is trying to probably, find a suitable territory for himself. And he will disperse out of a high density area. So dispersal is just a one-time movement. He might either head out towards Melghat, or maybe towards Nagdira, or to Kanha, or to Satpuda. I mean, Pench is very well connected. It's bang in the center of the landscape. So there's connectivity on all four directions from Pench. So this tiger potentially can go anywhere. And so this is the natural process, how tigers disperse out when they grow up. Like, as tourists, when we go, we say that wo tiger ki maa usko bhaga deti hai. The mother drives the cub away, is what they say. But I think, there are different ecological processes. It's probably density, competition with other individuals. This guy is, young and inexperienced, so he wants to move out and find a territory for himself. Now, this is the natural process. Now, when as scientists, when we model this, mathematically, so the NTCA, the National Tiger Conservation Authority, which is the nodal authority for tiger conservation, so they have done some simulations, mathematical models, which say that if there is a particular tiger population, if we are calling Kanha as a population or Tadoba as a population or Pench as a population, so then, each population needs at least 100 individuals, 100 individuals within one population for that population to, be genetically viable in the long run. Otherwise, if the populations are much smaller and the tigers do not have any space to disperse out. Like the classic example is Sariska Tiger Reserve, which is also in central India, but it is completely isolated. Sariska, there is no connectivity from where a tiger can move from Sariska to another tiger reserve, say Ranthambore or something like that. It's a completely isolated park. So there, what is going to happen is the tigers which are resident in that area are likely to breed with close relatives. Maybe, they end up mating with their cousins or, their litter mates, which are their real sisters. Maybe they can even mate with their mother, for all you know, and that leads to, various kinds of problems genetically in the population. So the Central India is one of the biggest tiger landscapes in the country. I mean, in terms of forest area, I think, it is definitely bigger than, the Western Ghats also, or at least it, it rivals that in size. And Central India has got 50% of India's tiger reserves. We have 50 tiger reserves, 23 of them are in Central Indian landscape. So here what happens is, even in spite of having 23 tiger reserves, and maybe we estimate, from our studies that there could be another 70 protected areas which harbor tigers in them. Like, for example, at Tipeshwar, or maybe Dewas in Madhya Pradesh, which has four tigers. Tipeshwar has got maybe a handful of tigers. Umrait Karanla has a handful of tigers. all of these tiger populations are very small. I would estimate that only out of, you know, the 70 odd tiger populations in the Central Indian landscape, only one, that is Pench, would fulfill the criteria of having more than 100 tigers, you know, in one contiguous landscape. Otherwise, none of these populations are viable on their own. They are all dependent on corridors 100% for their long-term viability. Without corridors, these populations might survive for a few years, but then you slowly start seeing problems, and you know, then eventually they will go extinct.
Yeah.
So the corridors are highly important for survival.
Yeah, so to summarize, basically when you have parks, but if they are not connected with each other, then they start behaving like islands. The islands are places, think of an island deep inside, quite far away from the main landmass. Unless there are birds, which means they who can fly, there is no mammal that can actually cross between the mainland and the island. So if you have 50 good quality islands, but they are all disconnected, animals from one island will not be able to go to the other. And so our parks in Central India are like islands if the corridors were not there. Only because there are corridors, animals can move in and out, what is called immigration and emigration, moving in or moving out. So that is what is why conservationists keep talking about corridors. People generally write to me saying that first you guys said we want parks, now you have a lot of national parks and sanctuaries, and now you want the forest outside the parks as well. The idea, and while we understand the sentiments of people, we have to understand that the parks will be paper parks if these corridors are not there. And so while I would say the 80s and 90s was an era where we had to consolidate our protected area network, a lot of national parks and sanctuaries were declared during that period. Several tiger reserves came up. And now that we have done that, we need to go to step two, which is to consolidate the corridors. There is still a lot of forest in India. Some estimates say that if there is enough forest in India to support 15 to 20,000 tigers. And so while we bathe in the glory of success of tiger conservation, we must understand that we really have five times less tigers than the standing forests of India. And when I say forest, I'm talking tiger worthy forests. So, and therefore, if say I told you when I started this conversation that in the early 80s and early 90s, a lot of conservationists said that the tigers will not see the next century. But in fact, tigers are thriving in a lot of areas where they were not found during that period, which means that the corridors that existed allowed the tigers to move back into areas where they had got exterminated from. Similarly, there are elephants today in Bandhavgarh Tiger Reserve. There has been no record of elephants in that area for more than 50 years. There was no elephant in Chhattisgarh for so many decades. But because there is forest, the elephants moved in from Odisha and parts of Jharkhand into Chhattisgarh, and they actually crossed Chhattisgarh and entered Madhya Pradesh near Siddhi, and that they went to Sanjay Dubri Tiger Reserve, and there is a corridor between Sanjay Dubri and Bandhavgarh. We knew as tiger biologists, but because of that corridor, elephants could move in, and today you have a population of 40 plus elephants that are residing inside Bandhavgarh. So if the corridors remain, even if there is local extinction on some of our national parks and sanctuaries or whatever you call tiger reserves today, because there are corridors, tigers can go back if there is social acceptance for tigers in those parks.
Exactly.
And we have to understand that we should not give up hope on parks. A lot of people say, oh, this is a paper tiger reserve, there are no tigers left, how is it called a tiger reserve? There are several parks in India which are called tiger reserves, but they have either substandard population, which means that it is not genetically viable, or you have very few tigers, and any disease or a poaching incident can push that particular population to extinction. Now, do we lose hope on those parks? I would say no. Today, because of several reasons, those parks don't have tigers or have very few tigers. But if the corridors remain, tomorrow, when the protection improves, when the social acceptance goes up, there is no reason why some of those parks could be as good as a Kanha or Tarawa. And so one has to understand that corridors are lifelines for a lot of species. Tigers are just a flagship species. Lot of birds, in fact, lot of insects also move great distances. Butterflies we know of, that some of them actually travel thousands of kilometers. But there are so many other mammals and so many birds that use corridors. So now going on to Milind, the technical parts of it. So now we know that corridors are important. We know that there are lot of tiger populations which are stable in short term in central India. However, if there are good quality corridors, then you suddenly improve that sustenance too, and it becomes long term sustenance. It means over 100 years, you will feel secured about them. But why do you think it is becoming difficult to, and you and I know very well, that corridors obviously are linear features. And then when we talk of development, why is it almost impossible to not have an interaction between linear infrastructure and corridors?
Okay. So, taking the case of the central Indian landscape itself, I mean, you know, which is typical. Now, in central India, what happens is that there are 190 protected areas overall, spread across all these states, right from, I'm saying, Orissa to Rajasthan. You know, if we go from east to west, I mean, Orissa to Rajasthan, Orissa to Maharashtra. So it's a large landscape. It's got 190 protected areas. And we estimate that, you know, almost 100 of them harbor tigers at the moment. Maybe another 40 of these have the potential to harbor tigers. And as we are seeing, you know, over the last four All India estimations, you know, slowly, gradually the tiger numbers in this country have increased. And we are, you know, noticing, you know, more and more examples of dispersal of tigers. 20 years ago, nobody knew that whether tigers, you know, disperse. I mean, people knew inherently that, you know, this happens, but there weren't many records. Now, you know, every time you see there are, you know, more and more records of tiger dispersal getting noted every year. Like last year, there was a tiger which either went from Simlipal or from Palamu into West Bengal, Lalgarh, where it was ultimately then killed. So that social acceptance is very important. What you spoke about, last year we also had an example of a tiger moving from Devas in Madhya Pradesh to Gujarat, where he survived for a year and until he died. So the tiger numbers are increasing. We will see more and more recolonization of, you know, previously extinct areas, islands as you call them, because central India, we still have a lot of structural connectivity. And geneticists have estimated that, you know, world over, we have lost a lot of genetic diversity. Central India still harbors the maximum genetic diversity amongst tigers in the entire world. So globally, this population is very important. Now, coming to the question of corridors, I mean, you know, as there are some people who are asking questions about the number of corridors. So central India, if we go by the, you know, definition as per the law of corridors and look at the, you know, existing structural connectivity, which is very, very good, we have about 150 wildlife corridors just in the central Indian and eastern Ghats landscape, which is one big landscape. Potentially, even today, a tiger can walk all the way from Yawal, which is extreme west, to Simlipal. You know, he can, if he wants, you know, there is structural connectivity for a tiger to walk all the way from Jalgaon district of Maharashtra to Simlipal in Orissa. So these corridors exist. We have structural connectivity. These are, you know, very vibrant forests. And there's a lot of growing body of evidence of the functionality of these corridors, that tigers are really using them to disperse long distances.
So, explain to them what is the meaning of structural and what is the meaning of functional.
Okay.
Can structural, when you say structural, does it mean functional also? Or when you
No.
say functional, does it mean structural also? So that, I think, they need to understand as well.
Definitely. I will explain that, you know, segregate both of these. So structural connectivity, what I mean is, like, you know, for example, many of you, you know, would have know about the Kanha Pench corridor. So if it is possible for you to walk from Pench to Kanha And you know, almost entirely through a forest. You know, you if you decided to walk from one place to the other, you would cover forest, 100% of the time. You won't see any other non-forest area. So if the forested area exists in between two protected areas, that is what we call structural connectivity. There is the forest structure over there. But in some cases, if there are no wild animals over there, if there are no wild animals in that forest, if there are no tigers, then, you know, they are probably not using that corridor which exists. So wherever we find evidence of regularly tigers moving back and forth, you know, in both directions, or maybe, you know, take the case of elephants in the eastern part of the landscape, elephants migrate every year. So that wherever animals are using the corridor, we say that, you know, this corridor is functional. So there is functional connectivity over there. The genes are flowing from one place to the other.
Okay. So I coming back to my previous question. Mm-hmm. I said that, see, linear infrastructure, you talked about roads, you talked about railways. So they are straight structures. Right. And then corridors are also largely linear.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
They could be zigzag. So that nature of corridors and the nature of linear infrastructure makes them pretty much buddies. As in, it's difficult for a connectivity conservationist to avoid a corridor from being cut by linear infrastructure. That's what I want you to explain, because people normally say, so if you're talking about a protected area and a road is cutting through that area, you may say circumvent the forest, which means you can get the road out. But in corridors, oftentimes that may not be possible. So people need to understand that there is an alternative route generally for a protected area, but when it comes to corridors, it becomes very difficult for us to have an alternative.
Yeah. I completely agree with you. Like, for example, if this is a protected area, a round patch of protected area, so if this is a road which is coming, one could easily bypass that protected area. It's like, you know, we have ring roads to bypass our cities. So one could bypass a protected area and take, you know, a road or a railway line outside, like, which is what is now being suggested in the case of Melghat Tiger Reserve by the government of Maharashtra. But corridors, what happens is they are, you know, straight in shape. Also, Central India, most of these corridors are again very narrow and, you know, linear in shape. And then if there is a road which is completely bisecting that corridor, then even if I want to move the road to the left or slightly to the right, I will still end up damaging the same corridor. So in case of a corridor, wherever there's a road which is going north-south and a corridor is going east-west, I mean, you have this plus shape pattern, there is very little that you can do to avoid the damage, because these roads have also existed for a long time. And an alternate alignment here is often not possible, and the road ends up completely cutting that corridor. It just cuts it into two pieces. So that is
right.
Then part of the problem.
Correct. So therefore, that's the reason why we need to do a lot of science to allow both to exist. And that's the most difficult thing. One is either or is generally easy, because you say, okay, this is not allowed. But when you allow certain things and also want animals to move, is when you need to understand the movement of animals. And only then can you introduce mitigation measures or structures that can allow both. And so can you talk, Milind, a little bit, but very fast, about the kind of mitigation structures that you know of that exist across the planet, and some of those structures that you yourself and our work has actually made happen on the ground.
Right. So, I mean, one of the, you know, best mitigation, as we discussed, is, you know, to avoid the damage completely by bypassing the road, but which is not possible in, you know, many cases. It is possible in, you know, the case of protected areas, but corridors, it's not possible. Otherwise, the best mitigation is to avoid damage completely. And if suppose, you know, for some reason, you know, the road is going through the corridor, you have to build the road here only, there's no other alternate option, then what happens is you can do either overpasses or underpasses for animals to use. So an underpass typically looks like something like, you know, the flyovers in our cities. So Maharashtra has, you know, the only functional example of underpasses in India at the moment, with animals like tigers, leopard, even the gaur is using at the moment. It looks like a flyover in the city. It's about 5 meters height, and the animals actually go under the flyover. So the traffic is going from above, and animals are going from below that very safely so that they don't interact. So this is one of the major types of, you know, mitigation measures, which is the underpass. Another area, you know, possible possibility is an overpass, where the road is going below and you build an pass over the road, so animals go above the road. This is mostly feasible in, you know, hillier terrain, where, you know, you have hilly terrain on both sides, the road is going through, you know, the middle of that, and, you know, you can build an overpass on top of it. So animals can either go over or animals can either go under. So these are the two kinds, major kinds of mitigation measures, overpasses and underpasses, which will one has to build. And these are being followed all over the world. I mean, you know, the developed nations like, you know, North America, these kind of overpasses and underpasses are fairly prevalent, you know, in many areas, and they enable animals to cross safely. Then you would also have to do some areas, you know, maybe the road takes, you know, goes under the forest itself. Like you can build a tunnel in hillier areas. Like in the case of the Samruddhi Mahamarg, they are building 9 kilometer long tunnels. The longest tunnel in India is being built on the Samruddhi Mahamarg in the Western Ghats area. And so tunnels are another option, but they are expensive and often feasible only in hilly terrain. Then there are other kinds of mitigation measure where, you know, you fence some of the area of the forest to funnel the animals towards these primary mitigation measures. So, you know, more and more animals start using it and it becomes more effective. There could be other mitigation measures, like, you know, limiting the speed of vehicles traveling on the road. Maybe you put a rumble strip somewhere, speed breakers of some sort, some speed bumps which help the vehicles slow down. But more often, you know, I mean, traffic laws in India are not followed. So, you know, these are some of the lesser effective mitigation measures. The best ones are the structural ones, like underpasses and overpasses and fences to guide animals towards them.
Okay. Milind, we have 15 minutes.
Okay.
So we need to also take questions. There are some questions that have come, but I just wanted you to explain to people how the white paper that we made on Central India and Eastern Ghats, and now the other two that we are working on, what is a scientific process that one follows to be able to come up with a white paper like that?
Okay. The first report that, you know, we brought out, it was almost about, you know, 18 to 20 months of effort, a team of 4 or 5 people, biologists and GIS specialists working on that. It took almost, say, you know, 1.5 to 2 years to come up with that. So the first step that we did was, you know, to define the landscape properly, that is the entirety of the Central Indian landscape. You know, including, you know, portions of Orissa and Andhra Pradesh, current day Andhra, which is the Eastern Ghats also. So we chose to, you know, to take Eastern Ghats also into Central India because they are all structurally connected. I mean, you know, a tiger can walk through even today. There is complete green patch of forest all the way from, you know, Maharashtra to Orissa. So we defined the landscape properly. Then we set out to identify all the protected areas which are present, and we counted almost 190 protected areas in this part of the landscape. And then what we also did was, you know, like WCT, as part of our conservation research, we have been camera trapping, you know, vast areas of the outside protected area network. I mean, WCT, our research doesn't focus on the protected areas. I mean, we don't want to go and work in all the glamorous parks like Kanha and Tadoba and Milgard, but, you know, we'd rather focus on the corridors. So we took a lot of data on animal presence from the outside protected areas. Where are animals found outside PAs? Because there's not much known about this. And then we also requested the National Tiger Conservation Authority and the WII, because they have also, you know, access to a large repository of data ranging back the last 10 years. We integrated both these data sets. And what we did was we tried to model these corridors using the latest scientific techniques, which are widely accepted all over the world. So the first step was to identify where are the corridors. If you look at, you know, all previous literature, they will say that in Central India, there's about 24 to 26 corridors. It's a huge underestimate. We have identified 150 corridors in central India itself. So if you don't know where the corridors are, then how will you save them? So the first question starts with preparing good maps of these corridors so you know exactly what is it that you want to save. And then what we did was that, you know, we went to the Ministry of Environment website, and it is a gold mine of information. Everybody who wants to, you know, develop some kind of infrastructure or wants some forest land, he has to file a formal application with the ministry. So we went and we mined all of these proposals which align with the ministry for information. And we found that in central India, there were some 1,700 proposals for roads, railway lines, canals, power lines, transmission lines. So we found 1,700 proposals. Now, not all of these would be harmful to tiger corridors. So we started mapping these projects one by one on this comprehensive map of corridors that we prepared. And then we figured out that, you know, there are almost 399 proposals which will directly negatively impact corridors. So that is the target on which, you know, then one has to work with the policymakers, with the infrastructure developers. So we did, what we did was essentially a very simple task, but it was huge in terms of, you know, the number of data points, you know, to be taken, cleaned up, and then, you know, put together on maps. So what we did was first made a good map of corridors so we know what is it that needs to be saved. Then we said, what are the threats? So we figured that, you know, these 399 road, rail and transmission line canal proposals are the threat. We overlaid them one on top of each other using, you know, GIS techniques, that is geographical information systems. And that formed part of the solution, because now you know where are the proposed threats. So now you can work with the policymakers at the right time, because all of these projects are in the planning stage at the moment. So if you go and talk to people, then you can tell them saying, hello, your project is going through a tiger corridor and, you know, the law requires you to mitigate it. So they also have time to plan all of this. There's enough time to do ground surveys to, you know, detect wildlife presence. There's enough time to decide on the budgets. There's enough time to decide on the architectural drawings, the civil engineering plans, because it's a very complex piece of thing getting mitigation structures onto the infrastructure, which needs time. So the intervention has to be done at the right time, at the planning stage. So that is what we put out to, you know, all the policymakers so that, you know, they could work together to save corridors, connectivity.
Milind, there is a question which I will take because it's connected to what you're saying.
Okay.
That why, when there is economic meltdown, there are so many issues that the world is facing because of the kind of situations we are in terms of the economy. So when there is so much of a fund crisis, how is it feasible to build so much of flyovers or maybe overpasses and underpasses on infrastructure? So we are going to escalate costs if you do that. So what you need to basically touch upon is that the actual mitigation structure, when you compare it to the entire cost of the project, that mm-hmm. proportion, I think you need to highlight, because then people will understand that it's not such a big.
Right. I mean, yes, there have been concerns on, you know, where the funding is going to come from, especially in, you know, the last 6 months, you know, the complete economic scenario has changed. I'll just give one example of, you know, the National Highway 7, which is passing through the Kanapench corridor, where in Maharashtra, 9 structures have been built and these are being used by wildlife. In Madhya Pradesh section of, you know, the Kanapench corridor, there's 14 more structures under construction at the moment. I think both these structures have cost us about, I would say, 325 crores. And the entire National Highway 7, all the way from Kanyakumari to Kashmir, the expansion of that, I would estimate has cost us nothing less than 42,000 crores. So this mitigation is just maybe, you know, less than 1% of the entire project cost. And many times what happens is, you know, infrastructure projects get delayed so many years, you know, almost a decade. And the cost of inflation every year, you know, the cost of cement is rising, cost of labor is rising, cost of steel is rising, prices are rising. So, you know, the inflation itself, you know, every year is rising by at least 3% to 8%. And these projects also take years to complete. So, you know, the mitigation is actually a fraction of the cost, really. It's not even equal to 1 year's inflationary expense, really. So it's a myth, really, that mitigation is very expensive and there is not enough money. But I think there is plenty of money available if the planning is done at the right stage.
Milind, also, the mitigation cost compared to the cost of delays. Do you want to say something because of litigation?
Yes. Now, in many cases, what has happened is, you know, because the infrastructure developers have were very obstinate and they said that, you know, we are not going to mitigate, you know, we are not going to spend extra money. So these projects, like, you know, this typical Kanapench corridor, that project itself, National Highway 7, has been bogged down in litigation for almost 10 years. So we estimated, you know, using, you know, various economic methods to, you know, look at the project cost. And just the delay in implementing mitigation measures has cost us at least 70% more. I mean, what would have earlier cost 100 rupees is now costing 170 rupees.
Okay. So basically, delays because of litigations can actually cost much more to the exchequer than having mitigations at the inception stage so that there is conservation budget completely impregnated within the larger budget of the corridor. So, Milind, we have 6-7 minutes left. I'm going to read out a few questions that have come because I want to make sure that we answer all of them. First is, I think they are asking rivers, you know. So, multiple people have said, we have not touched upon rivers, but yes, rivers are corridors. But not just rivers, it has to be rivers with good foliage around it, which means if you have barren rivers, obviously, tigers can move in the night, but that way tigers can move through small towns in the night. So that doesn't make the town a corridor. So river obviously is a natural feature that tigers and lot of wildlife take. However, if there is forest around the river, so if the catchment of the river is good quality, that corridor becomes far more effective than just a river body. Yes, in central India, a lot of tigers move across the rivers, through the rivers. And that's how they reach areas which are sometimes 100, 200 kilometers away.
Right.
Somebody wanted to know if there are corridors between Bihar and West Bengal area. So because we have also included some part of Bihar in our studies. Are there corridors that exist between the West Bengal side and the Bihar area for animals movement?
Well, Bihar mostly, I mean, you know, the tigers are present in the Tarai area of Bihar, you know. So the Tarai Arc landscape actually ends at, you know, Valmiki Tiger Reserve, which is in Bihar. And then the remaining connectivity in the Tarai is all via Nepal. What has happened is, you know, Bihar and Uttar Pradesh are home to, you know, some of the biggest, you know, rivers in the country, that is the Ganges, the Gangetic floodplains. And these areas have been converted to agriculture thousands of years ago. I mean, all the way from, you know, the time of the Ramayana and the Mahabharata. So there's very little natural habitat left over there. And in central India, little parts of Bihar and the Kaimur Plateau are believed to still, you know, tigers do disperse from Madhya Pradesh and Jharkhand into, you know, that portion of Bihar. But I think generally, I mean, Bihar, there's very little habitat left. And connectivity between Bihar and Bengal, not really much.
And so basically, to summarize, a tiger from West Bengal cannot reach central India currently.
No.
So
West Bengal and some of these parts which are adjoining Jharkhand and Orissa, there's very little. I mean, the Lalgarh tiger was a central Indian tiger which went into West Bengal after 140 years. But at the moment, I mean, there's very little habitat in West Bengal and social acceptance was not there. There was a huge hue and cry, and ultimately the tiger died. It was a central Indian tiger which went to West Bengal.
Yeah. So there is a question about how much do tigers adapt to using alternative corridors if one used frequently is cut by linear infrastructure?
Okay. Our studies here in, you know, the Kanapench corridor have been very encouraging. I mean, I would say if the mitigation structures are designed well and built at the right spot, then almost, you know, within a month or two of, you know, the construction finishing, tigers have adapted. Like we have noticed that, you know, the moment the construction finished, within a month or two, tigers were using, you know, these underpasses and, you know, going below that. But the caveat is that it has to be, you know, of the right dimensions and has to be built at the right spot, of course.
Okay, so very fast. We'll have to do very fast stuff now. Tilari is a new conservation reserve in Maharashtra. So I will answer that question. They are saying Tilari, of course, is very small. And if it was a conservation reserve, it could have been even 200 square kilometers. It didn't have to be 29 square kilometers. And it forms a very important link between the forest of Radhanagri and the forest of Karnataka and Goa. So Tilari, despite it being very small, is definitely an important part of that corridor. The corridor is still intact, but the density of tigers is low because that part of Western Ghat is low density tiger population in general. Also, somebody has asked about Ranthambore. Yes, Ranthambore in Rajasthan, unfortunately, there are parks like Ranthambore is very good in terms of tigers, but it is hardly connected to other good quality parks. But all that is changing now because there are big projects coming, road projects and all that. And there, in some of these projects, they're going to go underground. They're going to build a lot of mitigation structures like they are doing on the Samruddhi Expressway in Maharashtra. Similarly, there they are doing, there is connectivity between Ranthambore and Dhara and all those areas. The new tiger reserve that has come, actually tigers can actually walk through. So we will see how effective rebuilding this corridor is going. But as of now, Rajasthan is relatively less effective in terms of securing their corridors. However, going forward, I see lot of positives coming out of the state, and they are going to expand the corridor network outside of Ranthambore because they have realized that despite having good number of tigers, because it's islanded, there is a threat to extinction of tigers in Ranthambore as well. There is a natural corridor between Ranthambore and Kuno Palpur as well, which is in Madhya Pradesh. It's about 50 kilometers and tigers are known to move. But we need to have better corridors than there are currently. So to people, please do, there is very little time now. So I would like to urge you to encourage people to go to the IGTV and other social media channels of WCT to go through this discussion that I have had with my colleague Milind. And there are three more discussions that are coming your way. And all four of them will be hosted on the IGTV platform and also on social media channels. Please keep your questions coming. Our email address is milind@wcitindia.org and Anish, A-N-I-S-H, @wcitindia.org. You could write questions to us and all those unanswered questions will also be responded to. So if you can send your names, then we can write answers to those questions. And I'm very, very happy that, you know, we have really been able to get the tigers back from the brink of extinction. A lot of credit goes to the government for holding on against all odds, despite having such huge human populations, despite having the kind of disparity between the rich and poor here, despite having so many other needs in terms of development, we have still been able to conserve one of the largest and the most charismatic carnivores on earth. It is the largest cat on earth, and India is definitely a world leader in terms of large mammal conservation. And I always tell people, my friends abroad, to come to India if they want to understand conservation. Milind, last words from you before it gets cut. So if this gets cut, all the best to all of you, and do watch the WCT handle today for three more sessions. Milind, last words from you.
Well, corridors definitely need a lot of support, and I would personally like to thank all the viewers here, and I would encourage you to, you know, speak up for the cause of corridor conservation wherever, you know, you see any news. Please post it in social media, get debates going, and, you know, spread the good word around that, you know, the challenge of saving corridors is still ahead. I mean, tiger numbers have increased, but that's only half of the battle won. We still have the other half to win. So definitely, please don't forget to speak up for corridors. Your support is very important because as citizens, I mean, you know, the country, the tigers, it all belongs to the citizens. So as citizens, it's also our constitutional duty to protect wildlife. So, you know, let's start doing our constitutional duty and, you know, encourage others to do it also. Thank you very
and
much.
And also, there is an interview of Milind that is published on our website on corridors, which is far more, which is talking about the corridors in greater detail. I urge you to watch out for that interview as well. It's already been uploaded. So I think that will give you much more information also about the white paper and so on and so forth. I will continue talking. If it gets cut, see you everybody. But yes, there are some more questions. So I will make sure. Why are there no tigers in Mizoram now? Well, there are tigers in Mizoram, in Dampa, a tiger reserve. Obviously, the Northeast is extremely green. However, there is huge amount of bushmeat hunting as part of the culture. People eat wild meat. Because of that, the density of prey has gone down. The human population has gone up a lot. And so over the past few decades, you see that there are good forests, standing forests, but the animals, large carnivores have gone down because as tiger needs food, space, mates, and good forest cover. If you have forest cover, but if you don't have food, you will not have tigers. That's why they are called the indicator species. So if tigers are not there, then it's like a symptom of the bigger illness. And so that's the thing. Another big challenge for the Northeast is now the relaxation on laws when it comes to palm oil plantations, because that is going to be further very devastating, because palm oil is, so if in India, agriculture is not zero for tigers. In the night, tigers will move, but palm oil plantations will destroy corridors or existing habitats. And so one has to watch out for that. 10 seconds remaining. Milind, I think we need to wish tigers all the best and everybody out here. All the best, guys.